name's Jeremy, and I've been living and working in Korea for about 6 or 7 years now. And I've been working with kids for about 8 or 9 years. So I have quite a bit of experience working with younger learners. And I'd like to identify a term that I use, and I call them yells. It's sometimes the way that you'd like to address them, but it's young English language learners. So if I refer to some person as a yell, I'm referring to a young English language learner. So first of all, welcome to Busan. This is our second annual Busan meeting. And I'm going to talk about some things that I use in the classroom to help motivate and to help students kind of get into the program. I know it's a lot of students study in South Korea, not because they want to, but because mom and dad pay for it. So before we begin, I'm going to first identify some of the major differences between teaching younger learners and adults, because the differences are very noticeable. Do any of you teach adults? Okay. University students, right? Anybody? Okay. Any of you have experience teaching adults? Okay. So, first, I'm going to identify major differences between attention span and motivation. Number one being that children are easily distracted, as you may have noticed in your classrooms. You've got kids throwing stuff around, spitballs. yeah, you get all sorts of things. Like in the picture, they're more easily diverted by other. They get more easily diverted by other things. Oh, it's a pretty day outside. With older students, in general, adults can hold their attention span for a little bit longer than kids can. And so I try to make sure that the activities in the classroom are varied, and that I have a backup plan at all times. I usually try to divide my class into about 4 different sections. And there's an introduction, which is, you know, how's it going? And immediately go into review from what I had been working with them the last time. Review is essential. And then I go into, maybe we go into new material. So you get introduction, review, introduction of new material, and then activity and close. And I'll go into greater depth. So, yells do need motivation in a much more immediate form. Yells cannot think about their future. More times than not, they cannot think about, how is this going to benefit me? How is this going to help me in my future endeavors? Kids don't think that far ahead. They don't think about tomorrow much, you know, much less thinking about a few years down the road. So motivation is essential inside the classroom immediately. You need to make sure that they are having a good time. If the kids aren't having a good time, they're not going to be into what you're doing. And the way that kids and adults think about grammar and words in general are quite different. The way that they organize in their minds, how does grammar work? Most kids don't even know what grammar is. They don't have any working knowledge of grammar. They don't have any other language experience. They cannot refer to their own language if they don't fully understand their own language to try and understand yet another language. They haven't mastered their first language, and now teachers and other schools are expecting the students to master yet another language. So we have to understand that grammar has to be taught in context, and it has to be meaningful. So here we have implicit versus explicit instruction. What's the difference between implicit and explicit instruction? What's the difference? Go ahead.
Implicit, you just spell it out, the grammar points that you're going to cover. Implicit, you give them an activity, they would touch indirectly.
Right, it's indirect versus direct exposure to grammar. So let's take a look here. The way that kids label particular things, I don't know if you can see that very well. You've got a car there, that's my wife's car. And the way that adults and children label things are quite different. That gives you an indication of how kids think about things. You give the typical definition of petrol or gasoline. Adults, what would they say?
I need one about an American car. Another contents in the world, how you said it. Like, I've seen some English, British words, small and taller, I've seen some British words, but they only look like the American, Canadian words.
Okay.
So,
well, I think it's important, even if you, I mean, that's a very good point, that they sometimes don't know what petrol. I think exposure to many different Englishes is essential. That children will be exposed to many different kinds of accents, the way that people pronounce pronunciation, different uses, different words that are prevalent in various places. So to label gasoline or petrol as one as adults would. And then kids, there was a study, I can't remember the name of it, I've got it in the appendix, and one study found that kids labeled it as milk for a car. Right, so I don't know of any adults that would really call it milk for a car, but that's how they think about things, right? Mm-hmm. Milk might be power for a kid, why can't it be petrol be power for a car? So, the way that we label things is quite different. For example, stars, adults would label it as objects in the night sky. This is just a typical example. Suns at night is how kids would call them, which is, it's right, isn't it? Stars are basically suns, are they not? Right? So suns in the night sky. So children tend to give a very much more, in their thinking, a much more literal explanation of particular lexical items. Here's another example, the way that they would label father. Adults might call it a male parent. A kid might call it mummy, who's a man, right? An adult figure that takes care of us, you know. Who's the primary caregiver when the baby pops out? Yep, it's mom. So, mommy was a man. I'd like to do a very quick experiment. I'd like for you to think of a lexical item or a vocabulary word, and I want you to think how you would describe it, and I want you to think how would your students describe it. In a similar context as this, like, can you think of a vocabulary item that a student would label differently than, say, an adult would label?
Moon.
Tough question, huh? Moon? Moon. Okay, the moon. How would you call the moon? As an adult, sure, how would you label the moon?
Subtle.
Okay.
That orbits the Earth.
Okay, celestial.
Orbits a planet.
Okay. And how do you think, how would a kid label the moon? Okay. A C-shaped thing in the sky.
A circle in the sky.
Right.
Cheese.
Cheesy?
The cow jumped over the moon. You know that story, the cow jumped over the moon,
yeah.
The
nursery
rhyme?
Right.
I think Koreans have the rabbit in the moon. The rabbit in the moon. I know a little bit about that, I'm not particularly clear about it, but they might say the rabbit on the moon.
They have abstract words like love.
Okay.
They just draw pictures of. I mean, you draw pictures of their dad, not even their mom, or their brother or sister.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good example. Love. Boy, that one, that's a tough one. All right. So, important thing that you need to think about is adapting several things to your student levels. How many of you are satisfied with your book and could just teach the book straight away to your kids? Not so many, I think. Right, of course you should never do that, right? So I guess the focus on this part will be adapting the needs to the kids, making sure that the material is suitable for the kids, and we're going to talk about the classroom first. We're going to talk about how we can adapt the textbook if we use a textbook, and then the way that we can introduce, present grammar to them. So, adapting the classroom, so many things go into how we can make the classroom a more conducive place to teach. Behavior is an essential part of classroom management that can be difficult in the best of times and impossible at the worst. And the way that we can deal with these problems, the way that we can kind of preempt problems happening, I'll have a little diagram that I'll share some things that you can use. And then some of you may have this available, some of you may not. Limited L1 use, or limited use of children's first language in the classroom, which can be beneficial, but not necessary. There's always a reason behind every behavior. And whenever a kid acts out in class, you kind of have to ask yourself, is this worth acknowledging? Is this worth punishing? Is this worth rewarding? Is it worth praising? And so we need to choose our battles wisely. Some kids act out not because they're particularly unhappy with the class. Might be unhappy for some of the reasons that we're not paid to deal with as teachers. There are a lot of kids have emotional problems that they carry from home to the classroom and can lead to very disruptive classroom behavior. So it is really our job to decipher these behaviors. Is this something that we should tackle? Is this something that we should address? Should we talk to our administration? What should we do? And that's the hard part. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. The use of rewards is very common in, I would say, almost every elementary school classroom. Rewards can weaken interest, weaken active learning, and they're often shallow and divisive. An alternative that I use for rewards, instead of physical rewards in this sense I mean candy, stickers, etc. I use a point system. And I try to be very liberal with the point system so that they don't put too much meaning into the points. Oh, that was a great job. So I'll divide the class into small groups. Try to make the groups as equal as possible. Try to encourage not such a competitive nature in the classroom. But then I'll just give points to give them just a little bit of edge to encourage participation. I give points for participation, not for correctness. I want the kids just to acknowledge something, just to try and give it a shot. Because as students get older, people are, they're afraid of making mistakes. Younger learners, the advantage is that they speak their mind, right? The filter, not there yet. So while you get like, oh, look, it's our fat teacher,
which I'm not an energy, but I'm an edgy man.
Yeah.
But I realize I'm an edgy man, okay?
Right.
that's how they see some people, don't they? But in other countries.
Yeah, it's not. Well, the thing is, I get ajashi, Yomo ajashi is my term. I mean, English ajashi. And I tell them, just call me teacher. I establish a rule system pretty upfront. And I have a co-teacher who's occasionally helpful. Active word being not frequent enough. And so what I get to do. And who's usually at typing away at the computer? Oh, kids are screaming, throwing things across the room. Is something wrong? Nah, go back to your work. Everything's fine.
But then there's that rule part there too. What do the co-teachers, the Asian co-teachers, do? Are they doing the discipline for you because English is going to be a barrack one? Okay, you have to be very careful there too, don't you?
Yeah.
Is it, let's take it. I can do the discipline, but I said, oh no, you do it. And they said, no, you do it. But at the end of the day, I would get in trouble, wouldn't I? Because I'm a foreigner.
Yeah.
And there's going to be an education barrier. There's going to be a barrier.
There is a language barrier. And I do try to get my co-teachers to enforce discipline, good cop, bad cop type things.
Yeah.
It doesn't always work that way, but I'll leave it at that. I've got some suggestions I'm gonna talk about using some alternatives. Overuse of praise. I used to give praise away like, oh, good job, you said A. High five. And I just learned to kind of, and then I went the other way. I did some research, and I went the other way. I just thought, okay, I want to see how well does it work without praise. Without any praise, kids just kind of like, you got the answer right. Good. I have just come to the point where you have to find a balance. It's really the overuse of praise that can be detrimental. If you don't give them a little pat on the back now and then, they're just not gonna, they're gonna realize that there is no reaction, and if I give them no reaction, they're not going to want to participate in future classes. The problem is with risks that it, with overuse of praise, is that they kind of become accustomed to just looking for that praise. They'll try to say the same thing again, like, well, that was correct last time, Lucy, but this time, it's a little different. And they're like, but Sunday, I spoke. You know, and so that came with overuse of praise, and now I've tempered that with praise for it's limited, and like, okay, that was very good, very good. Now what? You always challenge them. You give them praise, but at the tail end of that praise, you kind of say, okay, what's the next step? What else can you show me? So that they're still trying to improve a little bit. I almost say, like, you know, grammatically, they make loads of errors. And I don't focus so much on correctness. I'm trying to really promote a level of fluency. And with the overuse of praise, it really does divide up the groups. You get kids who really dig getting a lot of praise. You've got kids who just can't be bothered. So that's a problem with the overuse of praise. But light praise, as I say, can be helpful in certain situations. All right, okay. Punishment. All right. This has plagued me since I began teaching, because there are times where I'm like, you little, you know. It's really, really frustrating at times, because kids can say just really nasty things, and the teacher, co-teacher, right? And there's nothing, and there's like, did you hear what the kid just said to me?
Yeah.
He just said to me? And the kids think, oh, he won't know what that means.
Yeah.
Blah, blah, blah. What did you just call me?
And they don't think you understand.
And they don't think you understand.
They're like, hey, I know those two words.
So, right. That was one of the first things I learned. Thank you very much. But praise, while it is still admitted, it's still allowed in certain places, it has to be, you have to be so careful with this, because you can't smack the kids even, no matter how much you want to. You can't throw them out the window. Trust me, I've tried. No, but this is a really tough one, and I'm going to skip on. I don't want to spend too much time on punishment, but I'm going to show you some alternatives. Okay, can you guys, I don't know if you guys can see the list very well. These are my first graders, so I teach pretty young learners. I get kids, and I think they are an average of about 6 or 7 years old, Korean age, eight. And so I made some, this is my list that I got from a guy named David Paul. He's a teacher in Japan, and he has his own language school, and he wrote a book called Teaching EFL in Asia. If you get your hands on this book, it's very, very helpful. It's got loads of games. And he had some suggestions for ways to preempt problems that might occur in the classroom. Number one, treating little guys and gals as people, not as like, oh, how's my little pumpkin? Ooga booga booga, right? Treat them as adults. If you want to speak like an adult, you know, treat them like a person. This is really hard. I know remembering kids' names is like, oh, it's Yong-in, J-ho, and Tae-ho, and Jung-in. That's really hard. That's really tough. It's really tough because I see kids, I work at five different elementary schools, per week, and I'm all over. And I have some students, you know, there's more than 30 in most of my classes. Providing a relaxed learning environment is a lot easier, even just by the way that you decorate the classroom. Light is essential. In a classroom like this, my kids would be monstrous. With a little bit more light, you have a lot more productivity. You need light in the classroom. That's just first and foremost. Allowing student ownership of the class. Asking them, even if you have to do this through your co-teacher, what do you want? You know, teachers, kids will often say, oh, teach a game. Okay. Oh, teach a game. Like, and I have no problem. I have no problem with games. The problem is that the games have to be meaningful and they have to have something valuable to teach to the kids. And one thing that I've done that I'll talk a little bit is I've relabeled tasks in the class as missions. And when they say, oh, teacher, mission? You know, they're like, yeah, mission. And they get really into that. They're like, yes, mission. Instead of task, mission. And they just go nuts. They're like, oh, secret mission? Yes, this is a secret mission. Don't tell other teams. Right? They love that stuff. All right. Ensuring success. If you develop achievable, comprehensible learning targets, you want them to do stuff. And so you want to find out what do you want these kids to learn? That's very important. People just think, oh, just teach the book and then walk out of the class. That's done until next week. You need to have goals in mind for kids. Unfortunately, most schools, hog ones or whatnot, they want you to have them pass a test. That's the reality of working in South Korea, a very test-minded society. It's all about the test. And once they get past elementary school, middle school, high school, what do they teach? The test, right? How to pass the test.
And the talking, we're having the conversations, even at younger ages, they put a stop to it. So it's in the test.
Yep.
But
what they've started doing is they're getting rid of a lot of the hog ones. The government has tried to install after-school language programs actually in the schools, so that then you have, and it's much cheaper than a hog one. Hog ones cost an average of $200,000 a month. These after-school programs are about $50,000 a month, so it's at a quarter of the cost. But that also means that there's a lot more kids.
I feel very sorry for parents in Asia, actually. It's been big money. I'm lucky I have a son with me in Korea, but I think they spend a lot of money and there's a lot of pressure on them if you're a
student. Oh, absolutely.
I'm sorry for them.
They spend $15 billion a year.
Yep.
15, as of 2008, the common household income that they afforded, they would spend about 100,000 won a month and 15 trillion won a year overall in the country.
That's pressure.
That's a lot of money. Okay, so setting a good example, avoiding confrontations with kids in the classroom, that's really, really tough. Sometimes you have a kid, and the kid goes don't-team, you're like, you want to cut the kid's head off, you're like, oh man, if you don't-team me again, I'm going to hit you out the window.
And they all think it's funny, though, like, right? The teachers think it's funny,
huh?
Yeah.
Oh, no. It's not funny, that's the point.
Well, that's it, yeah.
Violent.
Yeah. I guess what's really important is that, like, if you can get your when you get a student that violates things like that, you've got to be sharp and quick, like, snap it. But then you move on. You don't let it linger. Kids, a lot of times, like, they get the feeling they'll start crying, right? And then they're like, oh, you're okay. Don't worry about it. Just move on, and they'll be over it. Kids have they forget quick. And being prepared, of course, is essential. It's very easy to kind of stroll in there. I know a lot of hog one teachers their first year, it's like, oh man, I don't work till 2 o'clock. I was out till 6, man. So being prepared is essential, even if it's just keeping a reflective journal. What did you learn from the class? I try to take notes after I teach. What didn't go as well as I thought? Sometimes you can have the best lesson plan ever, and then it just totally drops. So just being prepared, Because when kids know, you know, when you don't have something prepared, kids know that, right? They know it. Okay, so, all right, moving on to the next one. Limited use of ER1. I'm gonna skip past this part because a lot of you probably don't speak much Korean. It can be beneficial, but I'm gonna move along. I'm gonna go straight to adapting the course book. Books are very interesting, and when they're used in an appropriate setting, they can be very helpful. This is a great book that I use with my 4th, 5th, and 6th graders about Alexander and his terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day. And they loved it. The kid wakes up, he had gum in his hair, you know, he didn't do well at school. His mom got mad at him because he spilled everything all over the place. And so I try to identify with the kids, like, hey, if you have a bad day, this is the worst day you could possibly have, right? And so it gives a kind of cultural connection between you and the students. Like, you know, you give them a book that you enjoyed as a child, Goodnight Moon for your real young kids. There are texts and books available that you can use. You can find some pretty good younger learners books at Kyobo Bookstore that are very, very applicable to your kids. I think using with books, not replacing the text, but in addition, authentic materials are very, very helpful. And they help the student think about, this is what kids in this country are like. This is an experience of a kid living in another country, in an English-speaking country, and it gives them an example of like a typical kids' language book. Moving along. All right. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to give you an example of an activity that I use to teach grammar, and I use it to teach adverbs of place and time. Okay, we're just going to say adverbs of place. So what I do is you don't need to use any language. You don't have to write any language, but you do have to be able to show them direction and things like that. So what I do is I give them an example of, I will use real class objects. Oh, I want to do that. All right, what I'm going to do is I'll say, if the markers work here, I'll draw a picture. Oh, a perfect world. Oh. All right. Oh, there it is. And so what I do, thanks, man. So what I do is I just give them an example. And I'll say, I'll draw an arrow here. I'll draw an arrow here.
Prepositions.
Right. Prepositions. So what I'll do is I'll give them a board, and I'll make a grid. And what they'll do is they'll describe a room or something that they have. I'll tell them to draw their own room. And then what they do is they have to get information from another student about somebody else's room. And what I have them do is I have them describe their room to another student, or they can describe it to the class. So then what I'll do is I'll have a student come up to the board. The student knows nothing about his friend's room, but his friend has to tell him where something is. So what I'll do is on the outside of the room, I'll have them draw various objects. Sorry for the terrible drawing. I usually have this done beforehand. This is supposed to be a guitar, by the way. And I'll have this. So what I'll have them do is they will describe their room to their partner or to the class. And I'll ask one of the students, okay, Jimmy, where's the guitar? And he may not be able to say where it is exactly. So what I'll do is I will lead them, and I'll put, is it by the window? Is it near the window? He might not have any language available. So what I'll do is I'll draw a bed. Is the bed in the right place? Is this right? Kid might answer, yes. Okay. So where is the guitar? So he'll use body language to try and describe where the guitar is. Is it next to the bed? Is it on the bed? Oh, no. Is it under the bed? Oh, no. Is it next to the bed? And then I'll have them say, next to the bed, next to the bed. This does not, you can't do this in one class, but this is just over time. And this is with real young kids, like I said, 6 or 7 years old. As you get older, these students, just to reinforce this kind of prepositions, what I do is I'll do the same thing, except that they will have to draw this themselves. So I'll have one student sitting down, one student will come to the board, and they'll draw the room, and then I will have one student describe his room to the other student. And I'll make sure that they're not friends, so that they have not seen each other's rooms. So I just try to have them describe a real life situation, putting this into context, using meaning. To kids, their room has meaning. This is meaningful. Okay? When you have an activity based on, like, I don't know, do you know any kids that need to go to the supermarket or that need to go to the post office? Do you know any kids that need to go? What 8-year-old needs to go to the post office? Right. So what I do is, the whole point is you have to make it meaningful. It's just meaning. It's got to be meaningful. So what I do is I just, like I said, making it meaningful, making it visual. Anyways, we're going to move on from here. I don't have a lot of time left. What I'd like to show you now is what I did with my 5th and 6th graders. I made a video with these guys. I took a song that they chose. I had them vote on a song that they liked. And of course, they chose a song that I didn't know until I made the video. Right. Sat at home listening to Britney Spears. The song is called Lucky. And I'll play the video for you guys. I meant to play it last time, but I wasn't able to do it. I've got the technology now. So what they did is they chose a song. And I had them each, I had every single one of them write one of the lyrics down. I gave them a sheet of paper that had all the lyrics written out on a piece of paper, cut it into strips. And what I had them do is they had to take one strip of paper and then put it on an A4 sheet of paper and write the lyric either at the top or the bottom. And then they had to draw something to correspond with the meaning of the lyric. And it took about a month. I met with the kids 4 times. First class was choosing the song. Second class was choosing the lyrics, going through the lyrics. Third class was designing the sheets of paper. And then the 4th class was the final touches of the video. So I will go ahead and show you the video that I made with my 5th and 6th grade kids. I don't know how well this is going to work.
This is a story about a girl named Lucky.
Thank you.
I sent them all the video, and so they all have their own copy of it. And I still get students who say, like, teacher, song. She's so lucky. Yeah, okay. But I have my younger students. They're so lucky. We're not lucky. That's next year, man. That's next year. Hold on. So what I do is it's a month project that I do at the end of every year. And so these fourth, fifth, and sixth graders get a chance to really, you know, take what they've learned throughout the year and then apply it to music. This may not have much value to other people, but to them it's really, really special. It's their own creation. And I think that it can appeal to everyone in the class. Even if they don't really like the song that much, there's something that they can do. They can still take a drawing. I had four guys in my class that were like, we want the money one, right? We want to draw money, right? So the kid draws a swimming pool filled with dollar bills. And I just think that it's about meaning and putting things into context. And you can, with kids, this was a very, very small class that had shrunk him considerably over time. But you can still do this with other members of the class. I always choose a song that doesn't have too many lyrics, that's not too wordy. Even if you have 30 kids, you just find a way to break it up into smaller bits so that each kid still gets a say in how the video is made. And they rave about it. They still talk about it to this day. This was almost a year ago. And I just use the Simple Pro program on my Mac. There's a lot of programs, anything on PC-based stuff. It's really easy to make something quite simple like this. I take an A4 paper, write the lyrics at the bottom, have the kids write the lyrics at the bottom, explain to them what it means if you can, let them draw. I did this for other videos. I've got other videos. I had one of my classes did Yellow Submarine. I had another class to Take Me Home Country Roads. So I had them do songs that they're very familiar with, and I let them choose whatever they want to do. I don't say no. At this point, I think I'm gonna call it. Do you guys have any questions? Yes.
It's amazing. I love that. But I just like wonder, did you manage that project in regular class or after school class?
This is an after school class. I don't have any. I don't know if the principal knew what we were doing, if I would particularly get away with it. But this is an after-school program that I'm working on. And I would have, you could easily do this in Hogwash if you're working in Hogwash. If you're working in an elementary school.
That would be good for English
camps. Yeah, definitely. Definitely good for English camps.
And also, to join the classrooms, there's a translation that the children get a lower. I've done the song one too.
Okay.
But not as good as your one, I must admit. But the translation in this area that I live in, that the teachers always have to do a translation to for the kids to use that part. But not that I'm making it difficult, but it's true.
I think that you can. I think that there are songs that can be used at almost any level.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's a little bit of extra legwork, but I think you can find songs that kids can identify with, even if they just like the melody. The kids just like the melody. They don't know. I mean, my kids don't honestly know what it's like to be a pop star. They just like the song. They know the lyrics, but they don't really know what it means. And I just told them, even if you don't know what it means, tell me what you think it means. So I try to just, it's in, you know, meaning is inherent. I want them to try and figure out what does this mean. I think they got it.
You know the song "Puff the Magic Dragon." You know the one. But then, you know, like, I hate to say to the children, not that I'm a negative person, but the meaning behind that story, like the 16th, it was a drag thing, you know what I mean? So that might not have been, but I wouldn't tell them that.
But that's what's kind of nice about kids, though, is you don't really
enjoy
it. Personal enjoyment.
You wouldn't tell Lucy and this guy with diamonds either.
I'm going to be real positive and say you're doing a good job, but
right.
I knew what
was
behind that.
Sure. Okay. Do you guys have any questions or comments or? you left bewildered or like wondering what the hell I'm doing up here? Hopefully not. How did this guy get up here? Any questions? Okay.